was the roaring 20s, a time when flaming youth ran wild, and no one ran wilder than Clara Bow. Clara was Hollywood's first sex symbol, a one-woman revolution who shattered social and sexual taboos. She had it, the most desirable quality of the decade. And she used that quality as her personal ticket to freedom. Her limitless energy turned outward created a brilliant career. That same energy turned inward could destroy her. Famous, gorgeous, Fitzgerald's real thing, Clara Bow ran wild and free. But who could guess what she was running from? The truth would reveal what made Clara run. In the end, the world's most public woman stayed home. The career was long gone, the family far away. Despite calls and letters, she refused most friends. Clara Bow had withdrawn from a world she found too painful. Bedroom on the late show. The spunky, sexy girl with the big heart and even bigger talent filled the screen. There the demons stayed buried and only the good times lived on. There she was and always would be a cellular legend. A star. There's no birth certificate for Clara Bow. Her mother, Sarah Bow, had already lost two baby girls at birth. When she became pregnant once again, Sarah's husband, unemployed waiter Robert Bow, abandoned her. Only Sarah's mentally unstable mother was present when a third baby girl was born in Brooklyn, New York, on July 29, 1905. The newborn showed no sign of life. But somehow, her grandmother revived her. Through a miracle, Clara Bow lived.
There was a history of mental illness in her family on her mother's side. Her mother's mother had died in an asylum, a public asylum, and her mother was sent later to the same facility. Her mother was epileptic, and there was a great shame attached to epilepsy in that era.
Afterward, Robert Bow returned to his family, though he could not find enough work to support them. Instead, the Bows lived as ghetto nomads in Brooklyn's most notorious slums.
Clara was terribly insecure about her education. She really come up like a little stray cat in a way. Nobody had really raised Clara. Her mother was a disaster and her father, but she had just sort of pulled herself up.
The tenement flats in which the Bows lived had no hot water. Residents shared common toilets, creating unsanitary conditions. Perhaps the only wise decision Robert Bow ever made was moving his wife and daughter across Brooklyn to Sheepshead Bay, opposite the fairgrounds of Coney Island.
Clara and I would go to Coney Island quite often. She worked over there at one of the sort of restaurants that they had along the boardwalk. She always attracted attention. So whenever we walked past someplace, they'd notice her.
Clara developed into a lonely, hypersensitive child. For a escape, she turned to a brand new medium, moving pictures. There, in the darkness, Clara could forget the bitter fights between her parents, her father's long absences, and her mother's increasingly bizarre behavior. There she could nourish dreams of a better life.
She wanted to be an actress. She talked about it and wished it, and she was doing without a lot of things so that she could have enough money to take the subway up to one of the studios up there.
Since her mother said actresses went straight to hell, Clara imitated her screen favorites in secret, practicing for hours in front of a mirror. It was too silly to even dream of, she recalled. I could see what I looked like in a mirror. But when Motion Picture Classic magazine held a fame and fortune contest, Clara entered it.
She couldn't afford a picture of herself. Her father lent her 50 cents for one of those really cheap tintypes. She took the streetcar, she showed up, she turned in the picture, and to her amazement, she was called back, and called back again, and called back again, and she won. She won the contest, and the prize was a movie role.
She made the film, but ended up on the cutting room floor. Years later, Beyond the Rainbow would be re-released with Clara's scenes restored and her name featured above the title. Sarah Bow was dead set against her daughter's dream. Late one night, 16-year-old Clara awoke to find her mother standing over her, brandishing a butcher knife in one hand. "I'm going to kill you, Clara," she said. "It'll be better."
She told me about her mother standing over with a knife at night. Mother was thinking about trying to get in the movies, and her mother was just dead set against that. And mother escaped her, and I guess locked herself in a closet or in the bathroom until grandfather got home.
Weeks later, Robert Bow committed his wife to the same asylum where Sarah's mother had been sent. Surly and abusive, he would raise his daughter alone. A traumatized Clara would never sleep well again. Despite being cut out of her first film, she continued to seek work and found it in a Wailing Saga.
From the beginning, everyone that saw her, everyone that worked with her said, she's got something unique. And from the start, every performance she gave, here's her first film, Down to the Sea and Ships, she singled out by the New York film critics as being the most exceptional person in the cast.
Clara was working as an extra on another film in New York when Robert Bow appeared on the set to tell her mother, Sarah, had died. Clara never recovered. "I was dancing on the table with just a few clothes on when my mother left me for good," she would later sob. "I'd disappointed her. I'd gone against her wishes." But she could not hold up shooting, so Clara continued the scene, outwardly vivacious, inwardly plagued by grief and guilt. Still, she held fast to her dream, and within months was offered a contract by Preferred Pictures, a low-budget West Coast outfit in need of cheap talent. A week before her 18th birthday, she left New York's Grand Central Station aboard the 20th Century Limited. For Clara, it was a dream come true. She was going to Hollywood. Pictures chief, B.P. Schulberg, was sure he'd been rooked. For him stood a teenage urchin in a shapeless skirt and a tatty sweater. Unwilling to waste company time on a screen test, Schulberg barked orders at Clara Bow himself and was astonished by her response. She was, a witness recalled, an emotional machine.
Well, my father had a remarkable eye. He could really sense what aspiring actors could do on camera. He saw Clara very early, I think, in a screen test. And with all respect to my father's eye, I think there was something that Clara had that just jumped off the screen. That those of us who saw those early movies of Clara would recognize.
Other directors soon witnessed the same phenomenon. One of them, Frank Tuttle, summed it up when he said, "All speed and no control. Clara just naturally topped herself."
My father, who directed Clara Bow in 7 films, felt in a sense that he discovered her. She'd done other movies before Grit, but he realized how good she was, how sensitive as an actress, as well as having a face that was not like anyone else's. But he didn't feel she'd been appreciated, and he immediately thought that she was going to be a great star.
Within months of her arrival in Hollywood, Clara was named a Wampus Baby Star by the Western Association of Motion Picture Advertisers, the highest honor of the day for an aspiring screen actress. The award banquet was held in San Francisco.
The Wampus Baby Stars were almost all teenagers, and so they were accompanied by a parent, generally a mother. But when Robert Bow got to the train station, he was so drunk that they wouldn't let him on the train, so Clara Bow ended up going alone. And all of the other baby stars were very specific about the fact that they used words like sad, lonely, withdrawn, shy. And when you see the film on her, and she seems so carefree and fun, you see the real difference that's already starting, the divergence between who she really was and who she was showing the world she wanted to be.
In 1923's Helen's Babies, Clara supported Baby Peggy, Hollywood's very first child star.
She seemed to really enjoy what she was doing. I think it was probably the desire of her life to be an actress, you know, to be in Hollywood, to be a star. And she was becoming a major star. She was younger than most leading ladies. Later in Hit Girl, she was kind of a conniving shop girl who wanted to catch a man. But that wasn't her role at all in Helen's Babies. Clara played just a simple, homespun girl. She seemed to have a bubbly, enthusiastic, youthful nature, and that's what she seemed to play up. And she appeared to me to be natural and true to herself.
To profit from the demand for her services, Schulberg put his new find on a brutal non-stop schedule, often loaning her out to 2 or 3 studios simultaneously. In the next 2 years, Clara made 25 features. Long considered a lost film, the 1991 rediscovery of Empty Hearts provides a rare glimpse of Clara in an early drama. Budget productions like this allowed no time for rehearsals or retakes, yet Clara's death scene is a revelation. Simple and unforced, it still rings true. By 1926, B.P. Schulberg was paying Clara $750 a week, then charging other studios 4 times as much for her services. It was total exploitation, but money meant little to Clara. A self-described working girl, she was doing what she had always dreamed of. At the moment, nothing else mattered. Meanwhile, she was becoming a role model for the flapper generation. After receiving the right to vote only 5 years earlier, women now sought sexual emancipation as well. No one embodied this more than Clara. She was creating a personality new to the screen, youthful, energetic, and frankly sexual. It was the same image she was beginning to develop off-screen. In My Lady of Whims, Clara plays an heiress who flees her stuffy family for the bohemian life of Greenwich Village, then juggles several male suitors. She opts for marriage in the final reel. It's clear she will be no subservient spouse. Instead, husband and wife will live as equals. The plastic age pushed the sexual envelope even further. Accustomed to virginal Victorian heroines, audiences were shocked and thrilled by Clara's brazen behavior. Here was a woman who not only knew about sex, but displayed direct enjoyment of it. Clara Bow became the sexual revolutionary of the Roaring Twenties, overturning all rules of courtship by openly, guiltlessly pursuing men. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, Clara fell for her gorgeous co-star.
Gilbert Roland wrote a note, and he called me over, and he said, "Bunny, would you give this note to Miss Bow?" I brought the note over to Clara, gave it to her, she read it, and I remember that night at the hotel dining room, I remember them coming in for dinner together. It was a sort of a romance.
Roland recognized her vulnerability and passion, which gave Clara an emotional range far beyond the experience of actresses her age. So did memories of her haunting childhood.
She had one friend, she always used to say. His name was Johnny. There was a fire in their tenement. He lived below her. And he died in her arms. He burned to death. And for the rest of her life, she would use that in her work. When she needed to summon tears in a scene, she would think about that.
Clara's crying was something I think that anybody who was there would never forget. In those days, in the silent days, they had little three-piece orchestras. Clara would request Rockabye Baby. And when they played Rockabye Baby, it almost makes me cry thinking about it, but they would play Rockabye Baby, and Clara would begin to cry. And that just, stage tears, but real tears. It was something that she related to. Maybe the lack of a true motherhood, anybody really caring for her. Maybe the actual words of it, of falling out of a cradle, the hard knocks, whatever it was, it made Clara cry in a painful way too, in a memorable way. It always made her cry.
In 1926, B.P. Schulberg was appointed head of production at Paramount Pictures. Schulberg took his main asset with him, pairing Clara with top talent for the first time. Her biggest break yet came with Mantrap, directed by Victor Fleming, who would later direct both The Wizard of Oz and Gone with the Wind. Here, the warmth of her personality shines through as Alverna, a chronically flirtatious manicurist. Fleming was stunned by Clara's talent, a temperament that responded like a great violin, he told a friend. Touch her and she answered with genius. When Alverna weds a backwoodsman and moves to the wilderness, she soon succumbs to boredom and finds herself torn between two men. Fleming treated Clara as an equal, an artist of limitless potential. She responded by falling in love with her director. The result was Clara's best performance to date.
Everybody. She talked with everybody on the set. She was like one of the boys in a way, very easy to get along with. She didn't have the big superstar attitude at all. In spite of all the trappings of stardom, Clara didn't act like a movie star.
Opened to rave reviews and big box office, Paramount rushed to sign Clara to a 5-year contract, quadrupling her salary. Most of the money went to Robert Bow. Clara had supported her father since age 16 and would continue to do so for the rest of his life.
She never was able to maintain the kind of attitude that would help her to manage her money and manage her life. It really was like open house. In that way, she trusted everybody. She was just very naive and generous and trusting.
By this time, Clara was involved with both Gilbert Roland and Victor Fleming.
I heard a lot about her scandalous ways in Hollywood, even though she was just a very new actress there. But apparently she'd gotten a bad reputation, and she was one of the original floppers, and so I think she got she was sort of a lightning rod in Hollywood for things that people couldn't explain.
Her reputation hadn't hurt lines at the box office yet. By the end of 1926, Clara Bow was famous beyond her wildest dreams, and her biggest achievement was still to come. Born writer of racy bestsellers. She was as phony as Clara was genuine. In 1926, Madame Glenn wrote It, the only work for which she is remembered today. In an era when the word sex was not uttered in mixed company, It served as an acceptable substitute. So, B.P. Schulberg devised a publicity stunt. If Madame Glenn would proclaim Clara Bow the It Girl, Schulberg would build a movie around It, give Madame Glenn a small role in it, and pay her $50,000, more than Clara had made in her last 7 films combined. Madame Glenn was a snob, but no fool. She agreed, and Clara Bow became forever the It Girl.
It could be described as sex appeal, but that's almost too narrow, too confining a phrase, too shop-worn a phrase to describe what Clara Bow had. Because it wasn't just sex appeal, it was her wonderful, ebullient, 1,000-watt personality. She just lit up the screen.
completely reconceived by Schulberg's top writers, the film It could have been Clara Bow's own life story had she stayed in Brooklyn. Betty Lou, a plucky department store salesgirl, lays eyes on her new boss and sets out to win him. The Clara shop girl is as loyal as she is gutsy. When a pair of meddling do-gooders threaten to take her best friend's baby, Betty Lou claims to be the mother, knowing this will ruin her reputation and sacrifice her true love. Newcomer Gary Cooper, whom Clara demanded as her co-star in her next film, Children of Divorce. Off-screen, Cooper also became her latest conquest. On the set, Clara loved to shock the other actresses after a night with her new lover. Clara was an untamed little minx, said co-star Esther Ralston. She used pretty strong language, said another friend, and in those days it was absolutely taboo to utter anything like that in public. But Clara would. It became a smash hit, elevating Clara from movie star to modern icon.
There's a really good case to be made for Clara Bow being called the movie's first sex symbol. There were sexy women, attractive women before her, but mostly they were virginal types, or cute. And if they were naughty, and that would be the proper phrase then, they tended to have to pay for their indiscretions. Clara was sexual and unapologetic. That was the difference. And people really responded to that because there was a truth to it. She sort of set a pattern because she predates Jean Harlow. She was there first. And then that set a pattern for Marilyn Monroe and the other sexual icons to follow.
Clara Bow was more than a sex symbol. She was the most popular movie star in the world. She received a record 8,000 fan letters a week, many addressed simply to the It Girl, Hollywood, USA. Her films set box office records as crowds of loyal, adoring fans, male and female, young and old, filled the seats of movie palaces.
Was extraordinarily popular, more popular than people even realized in the late 1920s. You think of Greta Garbo, Lillian Gish, all these great names, great actresses. Clara Bow was more popular in terms of box office dollars, in terms of consistently bringing audiences into the theaters. She was right on top.
Although beloved by her public, Hollywood society scorned her, omitting her name from industry guest lists. Instead of attending her own premieres, Clara stayed home and played poker with her cook and maids. The situation only worsened when Clara revealed her slum childhood, meager education, and most shockingly, her mother's mental illness in Photoplay magazine. At a time when it was common for stars to bury their past, Clara's candor was a slap in the face to Hollywood's elite.
In a town that didn't have the greatest record for morality, Clara was considered below the line. I mean, Clara was looked on as a bad girl, and actually like a discredit, but Clara really didn't give a damn. I mean, Clara said, "This is me and this is what I do, and if you don't like it, lump it, and that's the way she was. She thought that they were hypocrites, which they were.
I remember when Clara Bow walked into the dining room of the Beverly Hills Hotel in a bathing suit and high-heeled shoes. It was an elegant dining room, and there was a hush, or else little murmurs of shock. And even a six-year-old knew that that was not what you're supposed to do. But for Clara Bow, it was the right thing to do.
Clara completely identified with her fans, and when a letter reminded her of her own childhood on Coney Island, she responded with spontaneous generosity.
Clara Bow showed up one day on Saturday at the studio at Paramount, and her press agent saw her. Now, she got 35,000 fan letters a month, but she tried to read them. She always called them my wonderful fan friends. So she said, well, there's this boy, and he wrote me this letter, and he said that he's selling popcorn down on the Long Beach Pier, and his parents are sick, and if I show up, maybe he'll sell some more popcorn, so I'm going to go. And when I interviewed this publicity man 60 years later, he said to me, I will never forget the look on that boy's face when Clara Bow showed up and said, I'm here to sell popcorn.
Clara's next film, Wings, released in 1927, became one of the biggest hits of the silent era, winning the first Academy Award for Best Picture.
I was 10 years old. I saw Wings. And like every young fella in America, I fell in love with Clara Bow.
Clara's heroine, Mary Preston, is so hopelessly in love with a World War I aviator that she joins the ambulance corps to find him. When she finally does, drunk with his buddy in a Paris dance hall, she is heartbroken. By the time of her success in Wings, Clara had become, as Featherplay put it, the most gossiped about woman in Hollywood. She juggled affairs with actors John Gilbert and Norman Carey, between broken engagements to Gilbert Rowland, Victor Fleming, and Gary Cooper. She even had a fling with a most unlikely partner.
My father, the theatrical producer, brought the original production of Dracula to the West Coast. Bela Lugosi was the star, of course, and Clara immediately developed a terrific crush on Bela, and she was in the audience maybe three times a week, and the gossip columns were just full of the latest about Clara and Bela. My father and Bela became very good friends, and one night Bela said, Ed, I want to show you something. Come in my dressing room. So they went into the dressing room and Bela closed the door. He took off his shirt and his back was just covered with little red bites. And he said, Clara, Clara.
The most notorious rumor claimed that at wild parties in her home, Clara took on the entire University of Southern California football team. In truth, she was an ardent USC football fan whose only close encounters at these parties involved dancing the Charleston and playing touch football on the front lawn. A decade after they parted in Coney Island, Catherine Mulligan visited her old schoolmate in Hollywood and witnessed one of these parties firsthand.
I don't think it was a regular party, but it was one of those things, sort of open house, everybody dropped in. She had an early morning call the next morning for filming, and so she excused herself and went to her bedroom. So that's when I went up to her bedroom and we talked, probably maybe a half hour. She was happy that she had made a way for herself. But I don't think she was happy like most young girls would be, that everything was all right in life and things were going fine.
Nasty gossip and nonstop work were not the only problems. Soon Clara would face something worse.
Swing it in here, Father. Come on, Father.
The most terrifying obstacle of her career. The microphone.
Is that in your picture?
No, you're safe there.
Okay, test it.
Virtually overnight, an entire industry deemed talkies the future.
One, two, three, four.
And actors who lacked a voice, relics of the past.
All right, let's go.
Okay for sound.
Clara Bow had a new enemy. For the rest of her career, the microphone would stalk her. Prepared Greta Garbo for 2 years before putting her in a talkie. At Paramount, B.P. Schulberg gave Clara 2 weeks.
There's no doubt that Clara panicked when sound came in and felt that she couldn't handle it. She did drop a G's. She did use ain't. She was a gum-chewing kid from Brooklyn. She didn't know how to talk right. And also, she had been raised in school in the silent medium, which was reaching its height when sound came in.
Like all early talkies, 1929's The Wild Party suffers from slow pacing and static camera work. Still, director Dorothy Arzner was awed by Clara's ability. The whole thing was emotional with Clara, recalled Arzner. She understood the emotional content of every scene. Whichever way she did it was so right, so alive. It was like a dancing flame on the screen.
Someday, some man's going to hurt you terribly if you don't learn something about the breed. I haven't any time for men. Helen, you've been riding too hard. It's time you found a change.
Interest in Clara's voice guaranteed the Wild Party's success. To promote the film, Paramount sent her back to Brooklyn. Here in her hometown, she was mobbed by fans. Clara was their very own Cinderella. Back in front of the cameras, however, her mic fright still plagued her. Rather than bolster her confidence, P.P. Schulberg rushed Clara into dangerous curves. At least this time, he let the legendary Ernst Lubitsch supervise the production. As a result, Dangerous Curves was a vast improvement, indicating how well Clara handled the new technology when giving guidance and support.
That's the stuff.
Well, Pat, you made it. You got what you've been dreaming about for years. So, not the way you dreamed, maybe. Oh, cut it. It's better than you dreamed of. Because you did it all yourself. You don't owe nothing to nobody.
Pretty much every Paramount executive at one point or another warned B.P. Schulberg that Clara Bow needed better material, that she was carrying her movies, and that if they didn't give her material that was worthy of her, that her audience wouldn't stay with her.
30 pounds overweight and more insecure than ever, Clara could not fit into a dress the designer Edith Head had created for her third film from 1929, The Saturday Night Kid. So Clara persuaded Head to let a bit player named Jean Harlow wear it instead. It was a big break for Harlow, who never forgot Clara's consideration.
Please don't say nothing now. Please
don't. Come my way.
Oh, please, miss, please don't say nothing to me. Please don't.
You miserable, common, vulgar hussy. You've ruined my entire pageant, and what's more, you're a thief.
star Jean Arthur recalled. She was so generous, no snootiness or anything. She was wonderful to me. Clara lost the weight easily enough, but she could not conquer her mic fright, and her confidence plummeted further when she learned that, on her next film, Schulberg expected her to sing. Though she had never taken a lesson in her life, Clara rose to the challenge so surprisingly and successfully that her next two talkies also contained songs. Amidst this latest professional triumph, her personal life was spiraling out of control. Within 6 months, Clara was beset by three front-page scandals. The first, her affair with a married Dallas doctor. The second, over alleged gambling debts. And the third, a courtroom catfight with Daisy DeVoe, her former best friend, now accused of grand theft by Clara. Devastated by Daisy's mudslinging betrayal at the trial, Clara was vindicated when Daisy was sentenced to 18 months in jail. But it was Clara, not Daisy, who suffered the consequences, as public opinion now turned against her. The Great Depression had begun, and everything the Roaring Twenties represented was seen as unforgivably reckless. As that era's embodiment, the It Girl, was an easy target for blame. Throughout her scandals and humiliations, one lover stayed loyal to Clara. Cowboy star Rex Bell.
Rex Bell was in a movie at Paramount Studios. Clara was the leading lady, of course, and I would see them in the commissary together, and they were so wrapped up in each other. It was very sweet to see them. I think that was the beginning of their romance. It was true love with Rex.
Goodbye, baby. I know it's going to be tough on you, but I got to shove off now.
Goodbye.
I'm sure there was a good deal of lust in some of her earlier relationships, but with Rex, it was a very, very wholesome attraction. They brought out the best in each other. His eyes brightened so when he talked about her. She was always my girl. My girl. He put such tenderness in that.
Behind her back, Schulberg now called his once brightest star, Crisis a Day Clara. Junior executive David O. Selznick took her side, arguing that her latest talkie, No Limit, is no story to make with Clara Bow at a time in her career when only a great picture will save her. Schulberg refused to listen. No Limit would become Clara's first flop.
And if they get you with me, they'll send us both of you, know that?
Well, we're married, aren't we?
Yeah.
Well?
Say, listen, let me tell you something about the guy you're trying to stick to. When I married you, it was because it was the only way I could get you. Well, I even said to the other fellas that when I'm tired of you, I'll get a divorce and kick you out.
Wait. All I know is what you said when you married me. Maybe it didn't mean anything to you. I don't know. Maybe you were lying all the time. Maybe last night you held me close in your arms and told me all the things against me. Maybe you were lying then. Why you stabbed me?
Well, you know I wasn't, baby.
By her next film, Kick In, Clara could barely function, resulting in a complete breakdown on the set.
All right, boys. Take the kid over to the
Well, she could not forget that the microphone was looming above her. She would be acting in a scene, and she'd be talking to the other actor, and unconsciously, her eyes would wander up toward the mic, and they'd wander back down again, and they'd wander back up again, and the director would call cut. And she was such a professional, and she'd never had a problem, ever, before, with anything. And she was so hard on herself, and she would feel ashamed because she would slow things down.
It's your big chance.
You mean, if you got that necklace, you wouldn't care where it came from or how it got there?
That's it.
And whoever had it wouldn't get in wrong in any way?
Correct again.
And you let Charlie go?
Sure.
No comeback?
On the level?
On the level.
She started to view the microphone as her enemy. She lost it. She started hitting the microphone until her fists were bloodied and she had to be carried off the set. And that was really the beginning of the end.
The incident never made the papers. It did not seem that anything worse could befall Clara, and yet it did. A smear campaign by a scandal sheet called The Coast Reporter. Dedicated to exposing Clara, The Coast Reporter charged her with drug abuse, lesbianism, bestiality, incest, venereal disease, and insanity. It was an unprecedented torrent of libel, unique even in Hollywood history.
She felt that she had lost all sense of privacy, any dignity had been shredded away from her. It was the most painful thing that could happen to a movie star. She was left to really in shreds, nakedly in shreds.
By May 1931, doctors were telling Clara to rest her shattered nerves or risk a complete breakdown. "Please don't be angry with me," she begged Schulberg in a letter. "I am sick in heart as well as body." After weeks of delay, Paramount released Clara from her contract. Once the most popular star in history, Clara Bow left Paramount a Hollywood has-been. She was 25 years old. Released from Paramount, Rex Bell took Clara to a remote area of the Nevada desert, where the two lived together openly. On December 3rd, 1931, the couple drove to a tiny town called Las Vegas, where Clara Bow and Rex Bell were married. The newlyweds intended to remain in Nevada, but when Fox offered Clara $150,000 for two movies, a staggering sum at the height of the Depression, she returned to Hollywood in triumph.
She read a fan magazine article called "Has Scandal Beaten Clara Bow?" And she was always a fighter. And she said, no, it hasn't beaten Clara Bow. And she signed a very lucrative deal with Fox to make this comeback, which she did. So it was an enormous rebound from being driven out of Hollywood a year earlier.
While B.P. Schulberg was ousted and Paramount went into receivership, Clara's comeback film, Call Her Savage, was a sensation. Clara played a tempestuous Texas heiress, Nelsa Springer, whose exploits were as wild as Clara's were rumored to be.
Well, read it. It's the town crier's columnist. So what? Read it anyway. Nelsa Springer is having a party. Judging by past experiences. All right, this is Black. Go on. Judging by past experiences, we don't know whether this item should be listed under society events or police court news. Trying to be funny.
At the film's climax, her past weighing upon her, Nelsa suffers a nervous breakdown.
I never want to see you again. This is why I had to bring you down here.
Marilyn!
The most gorgeous thing that ever lived.
Call Her Savage was a solid hit for Clara, but she dreaded making another film. Finally, to honor her contract, she agreed to appear in Hoopla.
God, go on. A big handsome guy like you must have known lots of girls.
There weren't any of them like you.
I'm not any different from the rest. Haven't you ever had a girl back home? that you used to hold close in your arms and kiss sometimes? I thought so. Couldn't you shut your eyes and pretend I'm her?
I'm crazy about Hoopla. She really moves you in this movie. And to think that that was the end is heartbreaking to me. There should have been more.
But there would be no more. For Clara, the joy was gone.
Couldn't you shut your eyes and pretend I'm
Hoopla was the last time Clara Bow would ever work on a movie set. I want something real now, Clara told reporters. She set her sights on a goal that she would find even more ambitious than stardom. Housewife and mother. Her first son, Rex Jr., was born in 1934, and her second, George, in 1938. The family lived on a 600,000-acre ranch in Nevada, which Rex Bell ran. There, Clara used her Fox earnings to build a dream house. Rex called it Rancho Clarita. Clara described it as my desert paradise. But her homemade heaven would not last long.
I think that Mother liked living on the ranch. In the original days, you see a lot of her out around the ranch. She was learning to ride and handle herself. She could handle guns very well. I think her problem with the ranch came when Dad was gone too much, and then she began not to like it. She was lonesome. If you think about it, a few cowboys and her boys is all that were on that ranch, and otherwise it was Joshua trees and sagebrush as far as you could see.
Besides her constant insomnia, Clara began complaining of vague aches and pains. Doctors in Las Vegas, Los Angeles, and even the Mayo Clinic in Minnesota declared her in good health. But still, the symptoms persisted. At first, Rex was sympathetic, but he had an enormous ranch to run and a new career to consider. In 1944, state Republicans nominated Rex Bell for Congress. Clara did all she could to dissuade him.
Mother had had enough. You know, she really liked people, but she'd had enough of the public life, so she tended to shy away from being seen in public places, having people kind of grab at her and so on, autographs and all that type of thing. And especially with the bad publicity and all that left kind of a bad taste in her mouth. Dad was very outgoing, always was. He was elected lieutenant governor in 1954.
As Lieutenant Governor Rex Bell, one-time movie star, crowns Pat Martin as rodeo queen.
Clara could not bear the prospect of returning to public life. Left with no alternative, she took drastic action.
Mother did not get up at the normal time I expected her up. I opened the door and looked in, and she was laying across the bed and kind of sprawled out. And so I walked in, kind of tiptoed, and I kept saying, Mom, Mom, and she did not respond. And so I then, when I couldn't get any response from her, went and got Marge Marshall.
So I went up to see what was wrong. She was in bed, and like she was completely out. They had ice packs on her head and the heat on her feet, and they'd get up in the middle of her, and they was working her stomach and everything, trying to get her going, and she just wouldn't wake up for him, but she had a note in her hand.
Those boys were kind of shooed away, and I don't know what transpired, but then an ambulance came out and got Mother, and they took her away.
Clara's suicide note explained she preferred death to public life. Though she soon returned home, the strain of routine life still proved too much. In time, Rex took his wife to one of the most prestigious mental hospitals in the country, the Institute of Living in Hartford, Connecticut. Here, Clara received intensive psychotherapy and other treatments, including electric shock. Memories, some repressed since childhood, tumbled out. Clara recalled her mother locking her in a closet while she entertained uncles to pay the rent. Clara's doctors also found that after Sarah Bow was sent to an asylum, Robert Bow had raped his daughter.
think she's given us a great gift, because given what her parents did to her, she could just statistically have become another abusive parent. And instead, she gave us the gift of her artistry. She gave us a legacy, which are her movies and her talent.
Off the screen, she disappeared like an overexposed negative, actress Louise Brooks observed to her idol. The only thing she was this image they had made for her.
She was the it girl, boy, she was it too. She was wonderful to work with. And when Elmer Glenn called her the it girl, as I look back, that seemed to change her whole life. She became on. And she just ruined her life just being it. She was on all the time. And her frame and her body and her costume just couldn't take being an it girl 24 hours a day.
In a desperate attempt to stitch her fragmenting world together, Clara had become whoever the world expected her to be, losing her own identity in the process. In 1950, after almost a year at the Institute of Living, Clara moved to Los Angeles alone.
Solitude meant safety. It was a way of controlling the world, of dealing with the world in ways that she could deal with it on her own terms.
Vain wife. He had a wife. Where is she now? What? Louise's hands never be clean?
No longer afraid her voice would betray her, Clara read Shakespeare and poetry aloud, recording her efforts for playback.
Love me a little, Lord, or let me go. I am so weary walking to and fro.
She got into that wire recorder, so she made a good deal of use of it. My brother and I used to slip out of there so we didn't have to hear it. And that told me a lot. It's got a little, around that time it got a little bit older, is why she was an actress.
Be whose jagged mountains lie on crest. Once lay the captive's bird, small life at rest.
Separated from, though still close to his wife, Rex Bell died on July 4th, 1962. Exactly a month later, Marilyn Monroe committed suicide. No one could relate better than Clara. I never met Marilyn, but if I had, I would have tried very hard to help her, she wrote of her successor. A sex symbol is a heavy load to carry when one is tired, hurt, and bewildered.
I had to be older before I realized that she had to have been an artist. Now, I saw Mother on screen in Color Savage, a very good movie. But then I got a chance to see her in Silence. I saw so many facial expressions right away in the movie It that I'd seen that on an everyday basis. And I said, geez, that's Mother. You could see what she was thinking, and I just thought that was amazing.
Clara broke her reclusive routine very rarely, and then only for special visitors, her cherished sons, and Gilbert Roland, an old flame who remained a close friend. Carefully packed away were the cards and letters she had received over the years from her wonderful fan friends. When you quit the films, one had written, I quit going to them. Don't believe all you hear, Clara. Your best friends are silent. On September 26th, 1965, the It Girl watched a telecast of The Virginian, directed by Victor Fleming and starring Gary Cooper. Just after midnight, the sound and light faded. At long last, Clara Bow